The Trade Department awards a 4.9 million pesos worth of Shared Service Facility or SSF project for packaging and labeling printing fabrication laboratory to the Don Mariano Marcos Memorial State University North Luzon campus. The so-called Fab Lab facility will serve as a hub for innovation and collaboration as well as growth, seen benefiting students and MSMEs in the region. Among the equipment turned over, print and cut large format printers, offset printers, direct-to-garment printer, laser cutters, and sewing machines. This is the third shared service facility project awarded to the campus. Before this, the school also got facilities for fish processing and silk processing. The Light Rail Manila Corporation planning to open the first five stations of its Cavite Extension project by the fourth quarter of next year. LMRC President and CEO Juan Alfonso says they're now in the process of making transport-oriented developments by building subways, more common stations, and railways. He's also bullish the public's commuting experience will improve and traffic in Metro Manila will ease soon enough. But Alfonso laments right-of-way remains the biggest problem for railway builders.
Our biggest problems continue to be right-of-way. So how that affects, you know, that whole issue will depend on, I guess the format, if it's a solicited proposal or unsolicited proposal. But that remains a big challenge. And you know, in our case, in building the Cavite Extension, we worked together. We were partners with government, and we found a way to get it done. So it's not impossible. It is difficult, but it's not impossible. The pieces are in place, no. So there's a lot that is happening. Several lines being constructed.
The Philippines' trade deficit narrows in August to $4.13 billion from $4.2 billion in July. This as exports climbed to $6.16 billion, while imports also increased to $10.8 billion. A welcome number, improving numbers from the declines we saw in July for both exports and imports. More details later on in the show. Asian markets opened broadly higher this morning following the lead of U.S. peers after dovish Fed speak. Oil and gold continuing to climb on the fallout from Hamas's attack on Israel over the weekend. The U.S. dollar edging slightly lower. Take a look at the board. The Nikkei 225, which is coming back from a holiday yesterday, leading gainers up 2.1%. The Kospi Index also resuming trade today, up by 1.6%. ASX 200, not to be left out, up by 1.1%. Speaking of the ASX 200, in Australia, the Westpac consumer confidence rose to 82 in October from ultra-low levels, with confidence rising 2.9% month-on-month. Business confidence unchanged at 1. Business conditions falling to 11. That's according to NAB. We're also keeping a close watch on China, which reported on Monday a 17% decline in new home sales during the Golden Week holiday. And looking ahead, for today, we're waiting for the IMF to issue its latest world economic outlook. We're also waiting for U.S. wholesale inventories data. Well, the Bank of England will release minutes of its latest financial policy meeting. We'll also be watching chip makers. That's after the Biden administration allowed Samsung Electronics and SK Hynix to acquire the equipment they need to sustain and expand their giant chip making operations in China. We also have this, Justin, before we get to the futures, Japan's current account surplus is at 2.279 trillion yen for August. This is a much smaller surplus, missing economists' expectations. And looking at the U.S. futures now, looks like they're still going to be going up when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Well, they did manage to shrug off the sour mood from the Middle East conflict overnight, bolstered by more dovish commentary from Federal Reserve officials. Fed Vice Chair Philip Jefferson saying they're in a position to proceed carefully after that recent rise in Treasury yields. And earlier, Fed Bank of Dallas President Lori Logan said the recent surge in long-term U.S. bond rates may mean there's less need to tighten again. Well, Vice Chair for Supervision Michael Barr says significant progress has been made on inflation. Looking at the board, the S&P 500 erased losses as energy companies led gains, with U.S. crude futures briefly topping $87 a barrel, while the Dow is up 0.6%, and the tech-heavy Nasdaq climbed by 0.4%. Looking at the big stock movers overnight, we're looking at oil companies ExxonMobil Corp and Chevron Company adding over 2.7% each. Not a surprise. We know that oil has been rallying. We're also looking at defense companies, which rallied with Northrop Grumman Corp up the most since March 2020 and Lockheed Martin Corp gaining 8.9%. Israeli companies listed in the U.S., such as Teva Pharmaceutical Industries and Checkpoint Software Technologies, also slipping in U.S. trade. The shekel dropped even after the central bank unveiled a $45 billion support program.
The Israeli conflict right now has the potential to have an impact on the markets. However, if we look at history, when these conflicts have happened in the past and they've stayed somewhat very concentrated, it hasn't really affected the S&P 500 or the markets in general. In fact, we've seen the S&P 500 hold up very well. It's when and if that conflict becomes a broader conflict, multi-nation, multi-country conflict, that has the potential to certainly derail markets. And we saw that in the Yom Kippur War, where it did impact the S&P 500 to the tune of 40%.
American economic historian Claudia Goldin is this year's winner of the Nobel Prize in Economics. The Harvard professor is recognized for her work on women in the labor market. She's only the third woman to win the Nobel Economics Prize. The Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences says Goldin provided the first comprehensive account that advanced the understanding of women's earnings and labor market participation. It credited her research for uncovering key drivers of the gender gap and which barriers may need to be addressed in the future.
It's women who throughout history have often been hidden from view and often uncompensated in ways that men have been by an economic marketplace. They have over time left that arena of home or family farm or family business and moved to the greater arena of market production. They've become workers. They have begun earning a living for themselves and for their families. Their lives have greatly changed, but the labor market and the policies of governments are often slower to respond. Now, the changes to which I've referred have been enormously large in almost all economies, and that is one reason why women have become an important and evolving economic force.
Artificial intelligence has been applied to all sorts of applications, and here's yet another one: designing robots. Researchers from Northwestern University in Illinois have used AI to design functional robots from scratch within seconds. The system was given a basic prompt, and the AI algorithm autonomously conceived a blueprint for a walking robot. One of the researchers calls its evolution in action and believes the technology will eventually be capable of designing more complex and useful machines.
So right now we just gave the AI passive tissue and muscle. So there's not a lot that the AI can do, but as we give it more components like bones and nervous systems and sense organs, or the analog of this in mechanical terms, electrical wires and pistons. As we give the AI more things to play with, we hope that it can result in more complex and more useful robots, but that remains to be seen.